please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Hello and welcome to the CNBC TV18 special. I'm Shireen Bhan and we're coming to you live from our headquarters, our budget headquarters here at the Confederation of Indian Industry. Joining us now, the Finance Secretary, Mr. Hasmukh Adhia, and the Expenditure Secretary, Mr. Ajay Narayan. Appreciate you joining us here at our CNBC TV18 budget town hall. We've got a packed lineup here of corporate leaders waiting to speak with the two secretaries. Mr. Adhia, let me start by asking you, sir, and my first question to you is actually more of a comment that's coming from the former Finance Minister, Mr. P. Chidambaram. He says, as far as the salaried class is concerned, the government hasn't done enough. In fact, what the government has given by way of standard deduction, it's taken away by way of the long-term capital gains tax. He's also done some calculations, sir, and his calculation is that by LTCG and the cess, the taxpayers will now pay 31,000 crore rupees versus the 8,000 crore rupees that they gained via standard deduction. How do you respond to that, sir?
Well, the calculations are perfectly correct. I don't want to dispute it, because what we have indicated in the budget is that from the LTCG, our estimate is we'll get 20,000 crore in the first year. And from the surcharge, the cess, 1% increase in the health and education cess, by which we'll get 11,000 crore. So on the whole, total package is 31,000 crore. But we have given some concessions for senior citizens. We have given some concessions for individual salaried taxpayer and some small companies. So all this put together is about 19,000 crore. So net to net, of course, we are going to get an ARM, additional resource mobilization, of 12,000 crore. But that 12,000 crore is nothing compared to a budget size of income tax of almost 10 lakh crore. So that is nothing. In fact, our next year's budget projection is 11 lakh crore for income tax. Now, increasing tax for 12,000 crore is nothing.
Okay, so you do take on board some of the criticism that's come in there from Mr. Chidambaram. But let me ask you, sir, because the government has now presented its fiscal consolidation plan, and you have decided to adopt the N.K. Singh Committee's report on the new FRBM. So that takes you to 3% by 2021. That is now going to be statutory that you will have to deliver on that number. But one of the concerns, and this is highlighted in your own memorandum, sir, is what happens to the Uday bonds. The redemption of the Uday bonds has been highlighted by the government as one of the key uncertainties. And you say, and I quote from the document, sir, that this is an uncertainty and it's anyone's guess what the fiscal implications will be on states. Now, the Uday bonds amount to almost 2.32 lakh crores, sir. So where will this then leave the fiscal consolidation roadmap?
Well, there are two key recommendations of the N.K. Singh Committee which the government has decided to accept. One is taking the total stock of debt of central government to 40% instead of 46%, which it is now. And the second is the glide path, which takes us to 3% of GDP by 2021, as you mentioned. Now, we are well on track. We have accepted both this. In fact, N.K. Singh Committee had given us the liberty of increasing our fiscal deficit by 0.5, if need be.
Which you've done.
We haven't done fully.
A little less than that.
Only, we've done less than that.
Yeah.
We had full liberty to increase it up to 0.5%, but we have been fiscally more responsible and we have decided to only use 0.3 instead of 0.5 in the current year. So for structural reforms, the committee had said the government should relax it if need be, but we have done it only partially.
Okay, but what about the Uday bonds and the impact of that? Because
Uday
it says it's anyone's guess on the fiscal implication.
No, Uday bonds are not to be repaid by Government of India, if I understand.
Yeah.
It is a state government's liability.
Exactly.
Yeah, but We will talk to the states and see how they can also match with our fiscal glide path. Because N.K. Singh Committee has primarily said central government's glide path. So we are more concerned about our own debt to GDP ratio and our total stock of debt rather than the state governments. But we'll talk to the states about it.
Okay. Let me ask you about the big scheme that was announced, Mr. Adhia, and that was the national health scheme that the finance minister announcing that this is likely to be the world's largest healthcare government-funded program. But what is the allocation, sir? The DEA secretary told me it's 4,000 crores. I heard you say 2,000 crores. How does that then become the world's most largest funded government program, sir? Or are we not being able to understand this correctly?
No. Please understand, it's not going to be a central sector scheme. It is going to be a centrally sponsored scheme, CSS scheme. So which means there will be a sharing of state and center in that. Most probably, I think it's 60-40.
Okay.
And That is one. Number two, the implementation modalities have to be worked out in the current year. So we will have to probably talk to the states and give them some kind of a comfort in terms of choosing which model to go in for. There are two models. One is an insurance company model. And the second is the trust model. So there are states like Gujarat and I think Andhra Pradesh, which are having a trust model by which the health insurance scheme is being given.
Okay.
So the entire expenditure of the government goes to the trust, and all the bills of the hospitals are footed by the trust. That is the model, vis-a-vis the insurance company model also. So even if you go in for a trust model, in order to discover the price of premium at which we will have to give fund to the state government, we'll have to go in for a tendering procedure. So all these modalities will be worked out. It might take 6 months to launch the scheme. But once we launch the scheme, then only the expenditure will start. And so only, as Mr. Jha mentioned in the press conference, this year's budget provision is there, which is only a beginning, just a thing. As and when, depending on what price discovery comes for insurance premium, we'll be augmenting the resources.
So, Mr. Jha, can you give us a little bit more detail, sir? Is it 4,000 crores? Is it 2,000 crores? And also, I mean, what should we then realistically expect? Because I go back again to Mr. Chidambaram's press conference a short while ago, where he said that, you know, even the premium, so to speak, has not been provided for. And I understand that the modalities are yet to be worked out. But can you give us some sense of what this is going to entail?
As of now, the budget provision is 2,000 crores, which we have provided in the budget for 18-19. And as my colleague, Finance Secretary, mentioned, once the contours of the scheme is worked out, further provisioning will be done. And the model, whether it will be a trust model or an insurance company-led model, what will be the sharing ratio between the states and the center, that will be worked out, and then further provisioning will be done. So, but 2,000 crores is currently available in the budget for this scheme.
Okay, because the scheme just sounds much grander than 2,000 crores that has been allocated for it, sir. I mean, the finance minister did specifically say it will be the world's largest government-funded scheme, and then we see an allocation of 2,000 crores.
Absolutely.
So one is trying to understand how we make sense
of it. That's right. That this is just to provide an assurance that the scheme is going to come and the scheme is going to be implemented with full vigor and the concern of the government.
Okay. Ms. Adhia, if I can talk to you now about what's happened as far as the oil subsidies are concerned, as well as the excise duty cut that you've announced on petrol and diesel. So there's a 2 rupee cut that you've announced as far as excise on petrol and diesel is concerned, but you've also hiked the road cess by 2 rupees, sir, from 6 rupees to 8 rupees. So can you please help explain to us what has happened as far as the oil math is concerned? If I take a look at the numbers, sir, road and infra cess on petrol and diesel, FY18, 4,350 crores. FY19, 1.31 lakh crores. Sir, can you help explain this to us?
No, it's very simple. It's nothing to do with the final retail price of petrol or diesel. And that's why we did not highlight this in the budget speech. But it is there in the fine print. What we have done is that there was a road cess of 6 rupees per litre of diesel, per litre of petrol, which was used for funding the infrastructure projects of road, rail, and rural roads, etc. Now, this is being changed. Instead of so what we are doing is we are moving 2 rupees of excise duty on petrol and diesel to cess now.
Yeah.
So virtually, there is no change in the final price of diesel and petrol.
Right.
It goes from devolvable kit to non-devolvable kit. That's all.
Okay.
It is
so
moving
states
from excise to infrastructure cess. And the second thing we are doing
is, which means states don't get any of it?
No, because the problem is when we are talking about ambitious infrastructure projects, which are only in the states, they don't happen, there is no territory of Government of India. All the infrastructure projects only in states, happen only in states. So if you have to fund some of these massive infrastructure projects, we have to have a cess which is funding it exclusively.
So the other question mark, sir, then is that you've accounted for only subsidies to the tune of 24 to 25,000 crores, if my memory serves me right, on the oil front, sir, which is pretty much similar to last year, as far as the oil subsidy is concerned. You're factoring in what, $65 or $75 per barrel as far as crude is concerned for the budget?
No, for the budget, we have taken whatever is the... No, basically, oil subsidies only in the... LPG, etc. There is no subsidy in petrol and diesel anymore. It is determined by market rate.
Yeah.
So right now, of course, we are at the cusp. We are at the cusp of $65 a barrel. Now, as Finance Minister was mentioning in the press conference, we'll have to keep watching how the oil prices move. But if there is any need, we may have to sort of, you know, take a hard decision of sacrificing some of our revenue in favor of customers.
What does that mean, sir? That means another excise duty cut?
If the need be, we may have to do it, you know.
If the need be, you may have to do it. At what price?
Need be.
At what price do you feel the need will arise for you to take another excise duty cut?
We haven't decided that, but we'll see.
But what's the comfort zone, sir? What have you factored in?
As I mentioned, we are already on the cusp. We'll have to keep watching.
You're already on the cusp, and if the need arises, the government will undertake another excise duty cut.
If need be. If need be, we'll have to do it. Right now, there is no such plan. As of now, we think the consumers can live with this.
Okay. Mr. Jha, let me ask you, sir, in terms of some of the flagship schemes, sir. If I look at the NREGS, sir, the RE of FY18 versus the BE of FY19, it's flat at 55,000 crores. The National Health Rural Mission, sir, there is actually a decline between the RE of FY18 and the BE of FY19. Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana as well, I think there is a difference of about 2,000 crores of the RE versus the BE of FY19. Can you give us a sense, sir, of the allocation as far as the key flagship schemes are concerned? Concern, as well as the quality of expenditure?
MNREGA, the budget provision was 48,000 crores. This was stepped up to 55,000 crores
in the supplementary.
The demands of the different states. And for next year, the provisioning has been done at 55,000 crores based on the estimations which the Ministry of Rural Development has calculated. And depends on how the monsoon unfolds next year. And if there will be more demand, we will consider it at the time of the revised estimates. As far as the Awas Yojana is concerned, see, both on the PMAY rural as well as for PMAY urban, there is a extra budgetary support which is being provided this year. So we have under rural a provisioning of about 23,000 crores. Which is 2,000 crores more than last year, this 17-18 budget. And in addition, we are providing them 7,000 crores in the current year through borrowings from NABARD. And in the next year, we'll provide 12,000 crores more. So in sum, you will see a growth of almost 30 to 35% in terms of allocations for PM Awas Yojana Rural.
Okay.
As far as the urban housing is concerned, we are trying to provide extra budgetary resources this year also in the 17-18 fiscal. And next year, 25,000 crores is going to be provided through extra budgetary resources.
Okay. Ms. Adhia, you know, before I get to the guests here who have a lot of questions for you, sir, on the disinvestment front, sir, and let me take that into the non-tax revenue. Non-tax revenue is also expected to decline versus last year. Last year, 1.4% of GDP. Next year, 1.3% of GDP. And you've also caveated that if the disinvestment actually takes place, dividend receipts will also reduce. But the question is that could you not have been more aggressive on the disinvestment front, given the fact that you have your RE is 1 lakh crores for this year, sir?
Well, nobody can blame this government of being less aggressive on disinvestment, because having put a target of 72,000 crore, if we have achieved 1 lakh crore already in the current year, next year also we just wanted to be realistic. We have put it at 80,000 crore, but nothing prevents us from making it 1.5 lakh crore if need be. We will be working in the direction of disinvestment, but the question is, instead of giving high-sounding target and then market starts wondering which company is coming into the market and market is buttressed, we would like to keep it secret and we just want to make a small beginning.
But why the need for secrecy, sir? Why can't you tell us what is the pipeline? You've been talking about Air India's privatization very publicly, sir.
When my secretary colleague Deepam secretary comes here, you can ask this question. How the market is manipulated the moment you decide which are the candidates for disinvestment.
Okay, we've got many questions here. Shobhana Kamineni, CII President. Shobhana, the corporate tax rate cut for the likes of you hasn't come in. I know that was a big expectation. What's your question for the Secretary?
So first, thank you for this budget. We expected it to be really populist, but I think it's popular So that's the fundamental. When it came to the tax rate cut, our expectation was broader, that it would be for everybody. But we hope that you'll continue the glide path in terms of your, and we do agree that you've addressed a majority of CII members. And so we're very happy for that. Even in the fiscal consolidation, this is very, very pragmatic. And more than anything else, you've addressed agricultural stress, another very important point. But you've also allowed and created opportunities for the public to private companies to start participating. And we hope that, you know, what we're seeing in the healthcare, I do think it is by far the largest. Obamacare was about 35 million. This is about 500 million. It is the most ambitious scheme in the world. It will be headlined across, and he'll be remembered for it as long as the execution is right. And for this, I'd like to, I wonder, how far are we in terms of, and where will private sector play? Because each one of your, whether it's agriculture, whether it's whether it's healthcare, whether it's infrastructure, I think that there's a lot of private sector, because it's again about jobs. Yeah. So where is it that do we have a number of how much job creation will go up? You've said it's 7 million, the requirement is 12. Will this budget do it?
Well, there'll be a lot of job creation for this. And everywhere we will involve the private sector. Health scheme also, there'll be empaneled hospitals where anybody can go and take their treatment. So government is not equipped to handle all the secondary and tertiary sector health needs. So we'll have to empanel private hospitals. Similarly, in our farmer producer organizations, where we have given some tax concessions also, we would like many companies to come up in the food processing sector and agriculture processing sector.
Ms. Adhia, I also want to ask you, sir, because, you know, the emphasis is on a lot of the off-budgetary support that the government is hoping for, and you really believe that that will do the trick. Because even if I take a look at the railway, sir, whether it's track doubling or rolling stock, again, RE of FY18 versus BE of FY19, sir, there is actually a decline in the allocation, sir. So your bet clearly is, and you hope that, you know, the markets will help you through when it comes to the off-budgetary support that you're hoping for.
When it comes to infrastructure, broadly, there are two categories of infrastructure, the viable ones and the non-viable ones. The viable ones of railways or NHAI can definitely go off budget. We would be very happy to see them off budget. So we'll help them get debt from the market, and they'll be able to do more infrastructure projects because of that. If need be, we can give them a little bit of, even if it is marginally viable, we can give them the support in terms of interest repayment liability, some bit of it. But we can do a large chunk of infrastructure project in the current year if we borrow more and put in more money there.
Minal.
Sir, I just want to pick up the thread of the question that Shireen asked you just now. But before that, two clear positive strokes on this budget being grounded on two realities. The first reality, Shobhna's already spoken about it, saying you have clearly recognized agricultural agrarian distress and attacked it. I have never seen such a slew of disaggregated infra projects in rural India. So that's point one. Point number two is that you have also recognized that this is a last year before a general election, and I'm happy that you have not announced any mega new infrastructure project. But you have been categorical. The finance minister has taken pains to explain that from the prime minister downwards, with his review of the Pragati platform and others, you are actually very intensely monitoring the completion and execution of all these flagship projects. So on both these, clear recognition of realities, my compliments. Picking up just 1 minute, so on off-budget financing.
We have exactly 2 minutes more. With
okay. Then on off-budget financing, a quick point, sir. With each passing budget, more and more of your sources of finance are moving to off-budget financing. And I think that is not as transparent from the public as we would like it to be. So can in future we have more transparency on off-budget sources of raising finance?
Yes, sir. We have exactly
we'll
two more minutes with you. You gave us 5:20, sir. So 2 more minutes we still have. Go ahead, sir. Ms. Adhia, you want to respond to that comment?
Okay. It's a suggestion.
Okay.
We'll keep it in mind. But there's no harm in taking all the viable projects to off-budget. And we have to find more space for non-viable projects.
Right.
You know? So that's what we are trying to do.
I know we're out of time.
These are clearly spelled out in the budget documents.
Right. I know.
Off-budget borrowings of each source is spelled out. And for your information, the new sector which has been added is education and health,
right?
Educational institutions.
Yes. Sir, my final question to you, the MSP, sir, 1.5 times that you are now promising. Again, what can we expect by way of allocation? And I go back to my conversation with the Economic Affairs Secretary, who seemed to suggest that the full impact of this will only be seen not in FY19, but actually in FY20. Can you leave us with clarification on that?
Well, one benefit of announcing some kind of a higher MSP is that the farmer gets some kind of a protection and the market also behaves accordingly. The second thing is the actual mechanism of procurement. Mm. The Government of India is planning to involve state governments also in the procurement process, because Government of India alone cannot do the whole thing. So Niti Aayog, sitting with state government, will find some solution to procurement part of it.
Right.
And that will really help. It will take some time, but ultimately it will help the farmers.
By when do you see it being rolled out?
I mean, as early as possible, Niti Aayog will call the meeting of states and we will work out some solutions.
Okay.
There are two or three alternatives available for that.
All right.
Which we have thought about already.
Okay.
And we'll discuss with states.
Finance Secretary Hasmukh Adhia and Expenditure Secretary Mr. Ajay Jha, appreciate you joining us here on the CNBC TV18 Budget Town Hall. Thanks very much for your time. Ladies and gentlemen, don't go anywhere. We've got Ravi Shankar Prasad, the Law Minister and the IT Minister, joining us right here on the CNBC TV18 Budget Town Hall. We're back in a moment. Live on the program is Ravi Shankar Prasad, the Law Minister, as well as the IT Minister. Mr. Prasad, appreciate you joining us here on CNBC TV18. The budget, sir, has picked up on one of your key themes, and that is to create manufacturing of things like mobile phones, etc., in India. But the route to that seems to be a hike in customs duty. We've seen the customs duty on mobile phones being hiked from 15% to 20%, sir. Is that going to be the way to continue to disincentivize imports and incentivize manufacturing?
Well, that is, Shireen, one of the ways. You may recall when our government has come to power, there were only two mobile manufacturing units in the country. Now there are 115. You know, Noida and Greater Noida is emerging as a big hub. About 45 plus factories, including of charger and batteries, have started producing. They are giving a large number of employment. And India is becoming, our whole take is make in India for India and also export outside Middle East, neighboring countries. And this initiative of ours, apart from straightening a lot of policy initiative, it started giving a lot of results. You see that. Therefore, if India has the capacity, and not only in mobile manufacturing, also automobile, you can the whole solar panels, medical electronics, I have segregated from General Electronics. All these initiatives are working together to make India an important hub of electronic manufacturing in the quest for Make in India.
Well, sir, since we're speaking of Make in India, I've got with me the indirect tax head of PwC, Prateek Jain, and he has a question for you on the Make in India initiative. Prateek, go ahead with your question for Mr. Prasad.
Yes, so sir, as you mentioned about Make in India, you know, and therefore the duty rates had to be increased. But sir, we have come after a long time in the era of very, very high custom duty rates. Till a few years back, it used to be 50, 60, 70%. And now we had a peak duty rate of 10%. Now, effectively, what has happened now is that peak duty rate has increased to effectively 20% on many items. So is this something, from a policy standpoint, the government is likely to continue? Or it is only a short-term measure, let's say for 1 or 2 years, till the time you see domestic manufacturing stabilizing in India?
I can't give you any time frame. Obviously, it cannot be a long-term solution or long-term way out. As I said to Shireen's query, it is one of the measures. The larger measure is to make in India a success story, products of quality, giving more employment. I would request you to walk in some of the mobile factories in Noida, and it is a pleasure to see 5,000, 4,000 boys and girls working. Why only this? I am promoting BPO in small towns of India. In 2015, I came with this program, and today you'll be happy to know that we have got BPO already started in places like Imphal, like Kohima, Guwahati, Dibrugarh, Patna, Muzaffarpur, Kanpur, Allahabad, Lucknow, Bareilly, or Aurangabad, Nagpur, Wardha, and even South India. This is how we work. We are making 6 crore Indian digitally literate. Therefore, it is all a part of the whole process to make India a digitally powerful country. And I am also, I can say on this channel, I have already taken 2-3 meetings. McKinsey is preparing a report for that to make Indian digital economy a $1 trillion economy in the coming 5 to 7 years. And when today also the finance minister talked of digital economy. When I talk of digital economy, I mean communication, IT, IT-enabled services, startup movement, digital payment, e-commerce, new technology like artificial intelligence, etc., cybersecurity. All these are working together to make India a digitally empowered society.
Mr. Prasad, I know you have limited time, sir, so I will shoot 2 more questions your way if you allow me, sir. I want to talk to you about the BharatNet plan, sir, because that is something, again, that you have been overseeing for a while now, sir. Today in the budget, the finance minister allocating about 10,000 crore rupees to augment the rural telecom infrastructure further, sir. Can you give us an update on the plans as far as the government's Digital India Drive are concerned? And secondly, sir, my question is related to the finance minister's statement on cryptocurrencies. He reiterated the fact that cryptocurrencies are not legal tender. As the law minister, sir, what can we expect by way of action? Because he also talked about a clamp down on illegitimate transactions using cryptocurrencies. So can you tell us if there has been some discussion, some deliberation on the issue of cryptocurrencies along with the finance ministry, sir?
I would reply to both your queries. I had occasion to handle the communication portfolio for 2 years. When our government has come to power, the BharatNet was 358 kilometers in 3 years. That was our legacy. We have made 240,000 kilometers in 3.5 years. We have laid optical fiber in India, the highest ever since independence, in 3.5 years. Now 1 lakh gram panchayats have already been linked with optical fiber. Today 5 lakh optical Wi-Fi center is sought to be established. By new technology we are going to, in Northeast also we are going for improvement of the entire infrastructure. You may have seen there was a meeting with all the telecom operators to further have investment. My common service centers, which are also going to be involved in this whole digital payment and Wi-Fi installation for small groups of people, installation of BPO movement in small gram panchayat. I'd like to briefly talk about common service center. Today, 1 million boys and girls work in that. 46,000 are women entrepreneurs, giving 300 digital delivery of services, and they've earned cool 1,200 crores in the last 3.5 years. That's how we are creating empowerment and enterprise. And therefore, this optical fiber network linking 250,000 gram panchayat is designed to digitally empower and create platform from where other services can be delivered. Now, talking about cryptocurrency, I'm happy you have asked me this question. Cryptocurrency is illegal in most of the countries. Whenever you look at a currency, in India, we have got the photo of Mahatma Gandhi and the signature of the RBI governor. On a pond in America, in England, there is the photograph of Queen Elizabeth and the signature of the authorized officer there of their central bank. The same is the case of America, the Federal Reserve, and the photograph of President Washington. Who owns cryptocurrency? Who is going to be accountable for its legal tender? And therefore, should we allow it to facilitate terrorist operations, corrupt activities? So we thought over the matter, and I was also a part of that group of ministers led by Arun Jaitley ji. And we have said no. Mr. Adhia was there, he was also there, a part of that process. Therefore, consciously and deliberately, we think blockchain we are encouraging, artificial intelligence we are encouraging, robotics we are encouraging, Internet of Things we are encouraging, all the new technology we wish to take together to make India a digitally empowered society.
Mr. Prasad, it's always a pleasure, sir. Thank you very much for joining us and appreciate you giving us time on a very busy day. Appreciate you joining us here on CNBC TV 18. Ravi Shankar Prasad joining us here on the Budget Town Hall. Let's go straight across to the Vice Chairman of the Niti Aayog, Rajiv Kumar. Mr. Kumar, appreciate you joining us here on CNBC TV 18's Budget Town Hall, sir. And thank you very much for your patience as well. Mr. Kumar, you know, we were just in conversation with the Finance Secretary, Hasmukh Adhia, And he said that it is going to be the Niti Aayog that will come back with suggestions on the framework as far as the MSP mechanism is concerned. I would like to understand from you, what is the timeline that you're working with, and what are the alternatives, the ideas that you're working with on the MSP issue, Mr. Kumar?
There are three sort of ideas, Shireen, on this. One is to look at, examine more carefully the Bhavantar scheme that is now being practiced on a pilot basis in Madhya Pradesh, and to see whether it can be replicable across the country. That's the first scheme, and which I suppose you know is about like a gap financing for the farmers, of the difference between the MSP and the average of a market price over the last month. The second one is to try and telescope the value chain for the farmer and connect him more closely with the agro-processing and agro-grading, etc., units, so that he can be a participant to higher value addition from this value chain, so that his incomes get doubled and he is not forced to make distress sales or throw his product in the fields, etc. So that's the second one, to essentially give him the wherewithal to go downstream in the value chain. The third one that we are looking at is, I think, in addition to that, but also in its own right, a unit, an institutional mechanism that you find mentioned in the budget for a better price discovery, forecasting information, to reach to the farmer so that he can take steps to change his cropping pattern with that information, and so that he is not caught in this web of additional supplies and falling prices. So those are the three or four. Along with that, the Operation Green in itself has the elements of better procurement for perishables, but that's not for the MSPs. But for the MSPs, those are the three schemes that Niti Aayog is looking at. I hope. We'll be able to do this in the next three months or so.
You're hoping to operationalize the scheme in the next 3 months, or you're hoping to come to a conclusion on which of these three mechanisms you will take forward, Mr. Kumar, if you can help us understand that?
Come to an understanding of how it is to be done, what's to be done.
Okay. Overall, sir, let me ask you about the budget now.
By all the states. Shireen, let me clarify. Shireen,
yes.
The scheme will have to be necessarily operationalized by individual states, and we'll have to therefore take the states on board, and that after we have produced the concept paper and the operational framework, we'll have to consult with them, and then put it into operation. So the first 3 months are going to be used to come up with the framework of which is the preferred model to go with.
Okay, so this looks like it is at least another 3 to 6 months away, sir. Then let me ask you, do you believe that enough has happened in the budget to alleviate the rural distress? And I'll ask you that in the context of what the economic survey says about the agriculture sector. Its share in GVA has been declining, rural wages have been decelerating, Rabi and Kharif sowing is down for both. Given the fact that you're still talking about a 3 to 6 month window before you can operationalize this 1.5 times MSP scheme, do you believe that enough is available in the budget in the interim to alleviate some of the pain?
I think there is, because the necessary condition for that is this very bold announcement that all Kharif crops will have 150% MSP compared to their costs. That's the first thing. The second one is the allocation already of the 500 crores for the better procurement of perishables. Because you see, the farmers' distress, Shireen, don't forget, is not confined to, in fact, the major financial, the farmers' distress comes from perishables and cotton and commercial crops, not from those crops necessarily, you know, the major big ones like paddy and wheat and gram and maize, because those procurement are there. The third very good one, and which we'll operationalize within a month or so, I think, is this leasing, is this facility for tenant farmers to be covered both for bank credit as well as for procurement by the MSP agencies. So far, it is they who suffer because the procurement agencies do not offtake the product that they bring to their market because they're not owners. And they also don't get bank loans or crop loans from the banks because they're owners. Now, we know that Andhra had launched a scheme, I forget the exact title, but which gives the rights to the tenants to get those loans and also to get procurement done by the agencies. Now, we are examining that scheme. We've already done a lot of work on that. And this is why I make bold to say that we'll operationalize that in the month. So those three things together, I think, will take care of a large part of the farmers' distress. And finally, this export target that the finance minister has mentioned, which is $30 billion worth, and the fact that he wants us to now do it in a whole, the whole thing to be approached holistically with the Ministry of Commerce, Processing, Agro-Processing, Agriculture, Niti Aayog, all working together means that we'll be able to come up with a package which will address the farmers' distress in very short time.
Mr. Kumar, we've got a live audience here of corporate leaders listening into you at the CNBC TV18 Budget Town Hall. We've got a question here coming in from Mr. Uni Krishnan of Thermax. Uni, please go ahead.
Dr. Kumar, about export incentives, there was no mention or allocation in the entire budget. You are fully aware of the fact that Indian rupees appreciated by almost 8.5% between the last and the current budget. So the overall competitive edge of Indian exporters in the service industry and the manufacturing industries already come down by 8%. And this also at the cost of a commodity price increase of almost 27.5%, especially in the steel industry, which all of us are supported with the minimum import price. We were expecting that with the additional dollar outflow going to happen on account of the oil price expected to go up or even to remain at the same level, government would address it. We are seeking your advice as to how are you going to address this problem going forward.
Mr. Unnikrishnan, I think the first thing, if I got my sums right, there is a rupee appreciation, and that's about 5.2% in real effective exchange rate terms, and that should be taken care of. I completely agree with you. I am of the view, I have been consistently of the view, that the Indian business and Indian exporters should be assured of the rupee not appreciating in future, because that's the way, one of the ways to maintain competitiveness. The foreign trade policy revision that was announced by the Commerce Minister earlier in the year, I think, had taken care of some of those incentives by enhancing some of the duty drawbacks, etc. But the major incentive, in my view, that has been announced by this government has been the assurance to take to absorb the 12% EPFO contribution for new employees. Now that's really effectively that if you expand your employment, if you increase your export orders, you get that 12% wage reduction, which is substantial. Now that should be able to improve your competitiveness. The second aspect, of course, is the extension of the Contract Labour Act to all the industries and sectors. So that's the second one. Now I think depending only on annually changing fiscal incentives are not the only way for export industries to gather steam. Niti Aayog had set up a task force on employment and exports. We have made some recommendations which are very sector specific, which are very granular. The Department of Commerce, on the basis of that, has set up a Department of Logistics and Trade Facilitation, which will reduce your transactions costs going forward. So those are all the sort of various schemes that I think would help exporters. Exporters, from what I know, are very often more interested in getting a better ease of doing business and getting their things sorted out in time rather than just the fiscal incentive. So the government is fully aware of this. The Prime Minister has now been talking about an export-driven strategy. And I think you will find that as we go forward, the government will take further steps to facilitate expansion in our exports, which, and some of which I have outlined already.